Mark 15, 15 says, "He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will not be condemned." Now, we have some members of the church who say that if you're not baptized, you're not saved. And they oftentimes like point to a verse like this. And I'll tell you what, I read it, and it says, "He who believes and baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned." Doesn't say that he who is not baptized will be condemned. It seems to me like if you can't be baptized, there will be some place in the Bible that says, if you don't get baptized, you're going to come. We say that in big, bold letters, because God is real clear that the things are important enough. If we just capture it, we wouldn't have to read into the verses. We'd be praying again. So I don't even worry about that. I have been baptized. And I encourage anybody who has not been baptized to be baptized, because it's all to do that. But if you die before you're baptized, you're still going to be the Lord Jesus. Another important part of salvation is faith. In Luke 7, 44, Jesus told the parable of the debtors and the poor old Pharisee. It says, "He returned to the woman and said to Simon, 'Do you see this woman? I entered your house and gave you no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. She gave you no kiss, but this woman does not cease to kiss my feet and kiss my hands. She did not have my head and so on. But this woman has been my feet and prayed of them. Therefore I say to you, her sins with her hands are forgiven, but she loved not. But to whom little is forgiven, the same you love will. Instead of her, your sins are forgiven.' Those who sat at the table with him began to say to himself, 'Who is this woman who forgives sin?' And he said to woman, 'Your faith has saved you.'" Faith in Christ is my salvation. Another very important part of salvation is to actually call upon the Lord. Acts 2:21 says, "The day of man shall come to pass, and whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Romans 10:13 says, "Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Now, if God puts something in there twice, it seems like that's pretty important. So it seems quite pretty important for you to call upon the name of the Lord. Like, you can't just expect it to happen by osmosis. It's actually has to happen because you choose. Basically, it's a combination of belief, faith, and then making a decision to act. There are some misconceptions, though. You know, Matthew 27:42 says, "He saves others, he shall be cannot save. If he is the king of Israel, then knock him down from the cross, and he will believe." Now, they thought that this was a bit of magic trick. Jump down off the cross, but that's not. But guess what? He didn't come off the cross. He didn't raise again. Those who were mocking didn't see it. God is personally a doing thing. And Jesus said it a couple times, and he told parables that there were certain things that just didn't understand what was going on. God is real clear. If you're going to be a mocker, if you're going to be a slanderer of God, you're not going to do something. That's why it's so important for us when we're out witnessing, planting seeds, not get too upset if somebody doesn't receive. Because they made their own choice. Salvation is not for everyone. It's only for those who are willing to receive. So, God's not willing to make themselves, but he knows that you're all going to be for themselves. And then you accept it. Another misconception was in Acts 15:1. Certain men came down from Judea and taught the brethren, "Unless we are circumcised to bring the cup from the Lord, you cannot be saved." As soon as you take Jesus and you trust anything, you've lost. Okay? Jesus' work on the cross is enough. You just have to accept that work. One reason that I'm here, that's why it says it's called the thief. Back in the old West, a number of men were upstairs in a boarding house, amusing themselves with being closed. And there was a cry from the street below, "Fire, fire!" The men looked at one another distantly. One of the windows blew orange with the flame. "Wait," said the dealer, "let's just finish this thing. We've got plenty of time. We've got a key to lock the back door." The men nodded in approval and they picked up their dark clothes. Precious minutes passed, one of the men became nervous as the flames lit through the now broken window. With dark eyes and a sweat-filled brow, he asked for the key. "Coward," cut his nails or cuff the key. He should have been in the rest of the door and waited with bated breath as the key was placed in the lock. "It won't turn," said the clerk. "Let me have it," said the dealer. And he tried in vain to turn the key and lift it in the oil. The story there makes it very clear. When we stand before God, we want to make sure we have chosen the right key in this life. We didn't come up with some God of our own making, some salvation of our own plan. Jesus loves me because I know so I can do whatever I want. It's not a good, bit of theology. You guys remember that there's a plan laid out for us in His Word on how we can receive the Lord and be served in the Lord and follow Him through and dying to ourselves. Nobody wants to die to themselves. I understand that. I don't want to die to myself. But I have to. It's part of the plan. In fact, in 2 Peter 1:10 says, "Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you'll never fall." Make your call and election sure. Now, it was automatic. Magic words, he has words. So we need to worry about our call and election. We don't have to worry about fear and trembling. We don't have to worry about that. It just happens. Boom. It doesn't just happen. You don't have to work for your salvation. But once you have salvation, you have to work. And in order to get salvation, you have to work. In order to figure out what you're going to do to get the salvation. But the gift is free. You just got to make sure that you get the right gift. The devil, he's real good at taking stuff. He's real good at false witness and false wonders and all kinds of false stuff. And he's going to convince you. I'm convinced that taking one purpose on this earth is to keep you away from the Lord. That's all. That's his whole purpose. And so he knows he's busy, and he's going to get many of you. And if you fall for one of his tricks, you take eternal consequences. So how are we saved? I mean, how do you get saved? First off, the Lord does it. Okay? You don't do it. No, your friends don't do it. We don't get somebody saved. We don't want to save people. John 3:17 says, "For God did not send us into the world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved." Acts 2:46-47 says, "So continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and finding favor among all the people. And the Lord added to their church daily those who remained faithful." The Lord added to their church. The apostles didn't add to the church. The believers didn't add to the church. The Lord added to the church. Because Ephesians 2:8 says, "For by grace you've been saved through faith, that not of yourselves, but the gift of God." Titus 3:5 says, "Not by works of righteousness we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of regeneration and the giving of the Holy Spirit." And Psalms 2:1 says, "Truly my soul silently waits for God, for him comes my salvation." Everybody seems to want to find some place to get salvation. Oh, I'm going to be a good person. I'm such a good person. I know I'm not. Because no matter how good you are, you know in your heart you've got plenty of bad stuff going on with you. And the word is right there. If you want to, it's heartbreaking because we're so good at deceiving ourselves. I imagine this. The number of times in my life, there was something called the boxer by Simon Garfunkel. And there's a line in there that just stuck with me for years. A man hears what he wants to hear. And it's so true. We are just such fools sometimes. And yet, our mind is set in a certain way. And it can be disastrous. 2 Thessalonians 2:13 says, "We are bound to give thanks to God always for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God, from the beginning, chose you for salvation, through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth." Sanctification being a state of separation from God. So how does the Lord do it? Different than the spoken word. John 5:34 says, "Yet I do not receive testimony from man, but I say these things to you, to to me, he said. Acts 11, 13 through 15. And then he told us how he had seen an angel standing in his house. He said to him, send me to Joppa and call for Simon to be with Peter. He will tell you words by which you and all your household will be saved. Then they began to speak the Holy Spirit for 110 times from the beginning. Spoken word. That's why it's so important for us to get out and speak to them. Because the spoken word, and it's the word of God, affects them as well. 1 Corinthians 15, starting verse 1 says, moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel, which I preach to you, which also you have received and in which you stand, by which you are also saved, if you hold fast to that word which I preach to you, unless you believe in vain. Hold fast to that I preach to you. How can I hold fast to the word that I preach to you if you don't preach the word to me? That's why evangelism is so important. There are certain sects of Christianity to think you don't need to preach to the gospel at all. It's your denomination and all this stuff. And I don't understand how you can even say that when Jesus, the guy, you know, if you're a Christian, you're supposed to follow that guy named Jesus. Okay? Not that guy named George on the street. The guy named Jesus. He says, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. Now, if he said that, maybe that's what he meant. You think he's got, maybe he got confused? Go in the world and watch other people preach the gospel? I don't think so. Okay? If you're a Christian, you should be following Christ. Why do you say to me, Lord, Lord, and I can't say it? This is a choice. John 10, 9 says, I'm in the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. Are guaranteed eternal rest from our neighbors. My question to you is, what are you resting from right now? What are we resting from? Do we have to rest that much? Hebrews 4:1 says, therefore, since the promise of remains of the time of his rest, let us hear the Son of Man of you, see you'll come further. Hebrews 4:10 says, for he who has entered his rest, and himself also sees from the work as God did for him. What are we resting from? Quit resting now. The Lord is going to take you into his rest. If he's taking you into his rest, then you have rest. We must be resting from something. We have to rest from the works that we've done. Jesus said in 9:4 of John, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no man can work. So, heaven's going to be so cool. I can hardly wait. But you're not going to be able to pray for anybody up there. No one's going to have any heartache to pray for. No one's going to have any family problems to pray for. No one's going to have a loss in the family. No one's going to have a drug addiction we can pray for. You're not going to have to say, hey, do you know Jesus? Because they're going to say, yeah, we better do it. This is the one life that we're given. This is the only time in all eternity, in eternity, this life is smaller than this in all eternity. It's the one time when you can actually go to somebody who's hurting and help them get through it. This is the one time. Once this life is over, it's all over. It doesn't help anybody for you to watch your television stuff. It doesn't help anybody. I'm guilty of this. It doesn't help anybody to quit playing video games on your computer. There's nobody being blessed by that. No, I'm not totally against doing that kind of stuff. There's some relaxation involved. You should rest about that time. Some of things we go on 24-7 and drop and die. But there's so much time that we waste. We have to choose to believe. We're fortunate to give our choice. You know, some people say, how can you say that Jesus is my response is, exactly, there is a way.